wanted to welcome you to our first Signature Series event. I'm overwhelmed with this turnout. This is fantastic. We didn't think we would get anything close to this, and so we really thank you for attending. This has really come out of a lot of discussions that we've had with business owners and business leaders throughout the community. This topic, succession planning, came up, whether companies had 5 employees or several hundred, and I know it's something that we worked on a lot in the bank as well, and so we thought this would be a perfect way to start the series. We do have 2 more scheduled this year, and we've got a lot of topics for the next several years, and some speakers already lined up, so we do hope that this will be an ongoing event for us. Before I get into today's presentation, I did want to acknowledge a few people. First off, Matt Brady and the Ale House for hosting us today. I think this is a great space, and I appreciate that. Also to Therese Reichman and Four Reasons for Breakfast. And I also would like to take a moment and thank Standing Stone Bank and the employees and coworkers for going out, talking with our individuals face-to-face, inviting them. Did a lot of work to get everybody here, and I really appreciate that. And also Karen Davis for putting all this together. She did a great job, as always, getting our event here planned and put together. So thank you for that. On your tables, I believe everybody should have a survey. If you can take a few minutes afterwards and fill that out, you can just leave them there. We'll collect them. But this is our first event. We'd like to know where we did well, where we could get better. And so as we looked at today's topic, succession planning, we're fortunate to have 2 individuals volunteer to discuss their pointers on succession planning. And we looked at both short-term, more of that unexpected event that might take you out of your business, how do you continue the business, and then also long-term, more of a planned succession from maybe one generation to the next, or from one family to another owner, those kinds of issues. And so we have Vic Christopher, he was a partner with Snyder & Company. He's a CPA, also certified in business valuations. He does a lot of tax consulting and business valuation work. And through that, he has gained a lot of experience in succession planning, and he'll give us his insight here today. And Brian Shonk, who's a partner with Dagger, Johnston. And he also works with a lot of business owners on this very topic, and so they'll be able to share a lot of his knowledge with us today as well. The rough layout here will be about 45 minutes or so of prepared remarks. I know they'll both take questions either through the presentation or at the end, and we should be out of here at 9 o'clock with respect to your time. So again, thank you, and now I'll turn it over to Vic and Brian.
Thanks, Jeff. And we're gonna kind of tag team this. When you talk about succession planning, it's not a tax thing, it's not a legal thing, it's a very broad topic. When Jeff first approached me about speaking at this, I was very excited. Succession planning is an incredibly important topic for businesses of any size. And it was kind of funny when Brian and I were first meeting to discuss this. We talked about, it was probably a decade ago, that our firm and his firm and a couple other people tried to do a succession planning session. And we had, 2 people maybe that attended. So this turnout is phenomenal. Because it is a critically important aspect of your business. And so yes, as Jeff mentioned, I'm a CPA, so I handle a lot of tax situations. I'm a CVA, which is certified in as a valuation analyst, so I go in and determine the value of a business, which is a key piece in any kind of succession plan. Beyond that, so I've seen it from a client perspective, helping my clients through succession planning, but I've also personally experienced it. I like to think that I am part of the second generation of Snyder & Company. Probably a lot of you knew our founding partner, John Snyder, passed away, unfortunately, a couple of years ago. But when John made me a partner in 2004, it was John, Linda Sheridan, and myself were partners. And while we didn't have a formalized succession plan, we did a lot of the stuff that needs to be done in succession planning. We started very early on transitioning clients from John, who was starting to back out of the business, to me and to Linda. And it took time to do that, meeting with clients and getting them comfortable with me and knowing that John was going to be stepping back. It's a time-consuming process. Now, there were probably things along the way that we would have done differently. I wish we would have gone through a process like this where it's more of a systematic approach to meet a partner's goals as they're wanting to exit the business. But at the same time, I think we also have learned from maybe the bumps we occurred along the way. So if we go to the next slide. So what do I mean by succession planning? Like I said, it's a very broad topic, but if you think about it from a typically in a large corporation setting, when they're talking about succession planning, you're looking at who internally can move up the ranks and fill these leadership roles. I kind of call that more of management succession versus the succession planning that Brian and I are more focused on. If you think of a company like Berkshire Hathaway, Warren Buffett's company, all throughout last year there was big discussions. I saw many articles about who's going to succeed Warren Buffett as CEO and chairman of the board for Berkshire Hathaway. To the best of my knowledge, they haven't picked anybody yet, but I think he's narrowed it down to two people. But when we talk about succession planning, what we're planning on mostly today is talking about what we see, the small and mid-sized businesses where oftentimes they're family-owned, but where the business owner is really looking to wind down, move on to the next phase of his or her life, more like business exit planning. Now, the management succession can certainly be a part of an overall succession plan, because if you have a succession plan that wants that business to continue into the future, well, you've got to have leaders within the business that are capable of taking that business into the future. So, why do it? What's the point of doing this planning? Taxes. Taxes from a multitude of aspects can impact how you exit the business. From estate and gift taxes to income taxes to odd, unique situations. One that I had experience with, probably 7 or 8 years ago, had a client, and when I refer to clients, I'm referring to, I'm not going to name any names or anything, and most of the ones that I'll refer to, you wouldn't know anyhow. But this business was a small one-man insurance company. He was a C corporation for a while. That's a corporation that pays taxes at the corporate level. Then as the owner of the business gets money out of the business, either as compensation or as dividends, they're paying taxes again. So C corporations have two levels of tax. I don't think in your business, Brian, do you see a lot of those anymore?
I haven't set up a C corp in 15.
Yeah, and for most businesses, they're going to be an LLC, maybe elect to be taxed like an S corporation. But in this particular case, this individual was a C corporation. He had made an election to be taxed like an S corporation. So an S corporation just has one level of tax. Well, he had worked out a deal with a gentleman to buy his insurance agency. $185,000. Didn't have any employees or anything like that. And basically, it was a transfer of that book of business. Well, when a C corporation changes to an S corporation and then sells its assets within a 10-year period, because that's what the rule used to be, you still get taxed like you were a C corporation, even though you made an election to be an S corporation. So an insurance agency, all it had was goodwill. It had an intangible asset. So if he sold that at the point in time that he was talking about, now $185,000, that means different, that's a different amount to different people. In his case, that was a big sum of money. And the tax effect he waited one more year, he was going to be outside of that 10-year window. So he was no longer going to be taxed like a C corporation. He'd been taxed just like an S corporation. So by waiting, it actually wasn't even a year, it was about 7 months, still had the buyer on the line. The buyer was still interested in buying this book of business, but I'm saving $15,000 in taxes. So planning for those types of things is an important part of the exit of a business owner. Similar situation where a C corporation didn't have time to make an S election. The owner found a buyer, wanted out that day, well, not that day, but wanted out, you know, in the very near future. So when she saw what she was going to get hit with from a tax standpoint, she about fell out of her chair because she didn't understand at all about this whole two levels of taxation. I quite frankly don't think she would have been very pleased with one level of taxation. But so, you know, we had to get kind of creative on how do we deal with this situation? What can we do to minimize her taxes? She didn't have a formal succession plan in place. Ultimately, we were able to take a position that there was a lot of personal goodwill in her business, and not to go off on a tax tangent, but personal goodwill gets taxed only at one level because it's personal. It's not a corporate asset that's being sold. But being able to think through those things and things like how a deal is structured, if your succession plan involves selling your business to an outside party, how that deal is structured can have significant tax impact. You know, how much of the deal is allocated to the hard assets of the business? How much is allocated to goodwill? Is there a non-compete? Those types of things all have tax ramifications. So taxes, and that's not even getting into estate taxes and potentially gift taxes, but taxes can be a very significant reason for doing succession planning. Risk, you know, if the owner of the business wants to exit the business, there is risk involved in waiting too long to put in a succession plan. Unfortunately, what happens oftentimes is as the business owner's health declines, so does business. And so the sooner a succession plan is put in place, the less risk there is to the owner. Options. Now this is very sophisticated graph here shows you quite clearly that if you start planning today, you have, as a business owner, you have more options from a succession planning standpoint. As you get closer to that end all be all, to death or disability, your options are limited. If you've done no succession planning, at the moment of death, there's not a whole lot that can be done, and unfortunately, bad things can happen to your business. Control. Succession planning, a formalized, systematic approach that begins with the end in mind, gives that business owner control over what's going to happen to the business. And value. I mean, much like this, if the business owner wants to capture the true value of the business, you know, not having a succession plan leads to value declining often. As the owner's health is declining. Let's go to the next slide. So, and as Jeff mentioned, you know, there's short-term planning and there's long-term planning. Short-term planning is the, you know, what if I get hit by a bus tomorrow type stuff. Or I guess in my case, it's, you know, if I'm running tomorrow morning in the dark streets of Canal Winchester and I become a hood ornament, what happens? The Snyder Company. Side note, buddy of mine that I run with, got his wife, she also runs, got her a reflective safety vest to wear in the morning. It lights up and everything. She got him a dark turtleneck. we spent one of our runs analyzing that. But from a short-term planning standpoint, you know, what if something were to happen to you? You know, what happens to your business? I have no problem sharing how we have things structured at Snyder Company. It's like I said, we have gone through a succession, and, you know, the business is still alive and running. Linda and I have insurance policies. You know, if something happens to me, the company is the beneficiary of, of an insurance policy that does two things. It takes care of my estate, essentially, you know, because if I die, if I become that hood ornament, my wife is now a shareholder, or my estate is a shareholder of Snyder and Company stock. I don't think Linda wants to be partners. No, Linda doesn't want to be partners with my wife. And my wife doesn't want to be a partner in a CPA firm. So there's a policy that pays for my stock to be bought back from my estate. There's also a policy that helps for that transition of a business. If I were to die tomorrow, there's a lot of clients that I have contact with, a lot of relationships that I've established over the years. If I die tomorrow, what happens to all those relationships? What happens to the business in servicing those clients? Now, there'd be a need to bring in another Vic, and as scary as that sounds, but to help continue the business. So, conversely, we have same types of policies on Linda. If something happens to her, we've got that covered. From a long-term planning perspective, a lot of these things that Brian and I are talking about, they take time. You know, if you want to do gifting, if that's part of your succession plan, is to gift stock from one generation, gift ownership in your business from one generation to the next. That might be something that you want to do on a structured basis over time. We've got a situation right now where every year, mom makes a gift to the kids of interest, kids or adults, to her children, but she makes gifts every year, December 31st to January 1st. A gift tax return is filed showing that transfer of ownership, but it's done so in a way that the amount of the gift stays underneath the annual gift tax exclusion amount, which is $14,000 this year. So what that means is if you make a gift that's more than $14,000, you've made a taxable gift. You don't normally pay taxes at that point in time, and it has more of an impact on that person's estate than anything else. But part of their plan is to stay under this limit. Now, with closely held companies, that's where a lot of the valuation stuff that I do comes into play, because we have to show what that value is of the two shares that she's gifting in this company. There's a reason why it's done on December 31st and January 1st. Those are two separate tax years, so she can do $14,000 gift, which might be 2.5 shares on December 31st, turn around and use that same valuation that I prepared and do 2.5 shares on January 1st and still be under the $14,000 for the next calendar year. But at the rate that it's going, you know, doing 2.5 shares is going to take a long period of time for ownership to truly transfer from her to the next generation. One of the biggest fears a business owner has is, am I going to have enough money if I move this business on, whether it's to the next generation, whether it's sold outright, how am I going to support myself in my retirement years? Well, again, there are things that can be done, but they can't be done on the very last day that you own the business. You know, if you've got a retirement plan, you're making maximum contributions to that retirement plan. You know, if you spend a couple years, you know, towards the end of a person's career, building up those retirement accounts, that's more money available in retirement. You could do creative things like a defined benefit plan. We had this situation with a physician client of ours. A defined benefit plan, I like to equate those kind of to the old style pensions that you don't really see much anymore, where, you know, you work for the steel company for 30 years, you retire, you get X dollars per month for the rest of your life, okay? Well, a defined benefit plan works for small businesses. in the situation that we had a physician that set up one of these plans. It worked out well because he was older, you know, he was closer to retirement. So it's all based off of actuarial tables and stuff, but it's saying, okay, to fund this future benefit stream, which he got to decide what it was, let's say $5,000 a month is what he wanted in his retirement, is going to require the business contribute $100,000 each year. Sure, his employees are part of that, but they were all younger, so their time period until retirement was a lot longer. So, you know, his company would make a $100,000 contribution to the defined benefit plan. $80,000 of that was really going towards his benefit. And it was all tax deduction in the current year, which he really, really liked that part of it. But, now the IRS says, you can't create one of those plans and then shut it down the next year. Because then, it just looks like you were trying to get on the taxes. They don't like that. So, you know, 3 years might be pushing it. 5 years to have that plan in existence is probably, you know, the minimum. So to put in a plan like that to you know, execute it properly and not have the IRS all in an uproar, you got to have time for that. That's part of the long-term planning. I mentioned this C corporation making election to a S corporation. That's now a 5-year window where you would still be taxed as a C corporation. But like Brian said, we don't see a whole lot of those anymore. There's really not much of a reason to have C corporations. Let's go to the next slide. Now, as I said before, succession planning is not just a tax thing, it's not just a legal thing, it's a broad topic. So, and it's hard, you know? Business owners are focused on operating their business. I mean, I know I am. It's hard to step away and think about these other higher level topics. And I think that's one reason why business owners don't do it. They're just so focused on their business, they don't want to take the time even for short-term planning to think about, if I die tomorrow, what happens to my business? They don't want to stop and think about that type of stuff. And the process itself is hard. I took one psychology class in college, so I'm not a trained professional, but there's a lot of emotional issues that go into this process. There's a lot of disputes that can arise in this process, and particularly in family-owned businesses. There's potentially the owner who's looking to exit. He or she has spent her entire life working on this business, building this business, and now all of a sudden talking about a plan where they're no longer at the helm of that business. And that's an emotional thing. They've become attached to that business. A lot of people see their self-worth in that business. You know, as a society, we, you know, oftentimes define who you are by what you do. And, you know, now this individual is giving up this business. That can be really challenging. In family situations, you can certainly have uncertainty about the next generation. And do they have the skills to really take this business and run with it? Do they have the experience? Are they smart enough? Will they do things the way that I did things? You know, those are hurdles that you have to overcome as part of the process. Family businesses in particular are very unique and have histories that those histories might create hurdles that have to be overcome. When you're looking at a succession plan, you really have three stakeholder groups. You have the owner, or potentially owners, you got family, and then you got managers of the business. And in a family business, you actually can't have, if you think of a Venn diagram, you know, the intersecting circles, you know, you could have a family member who is an owner, who also participates in the day-to-day management of the business. You can have a family owner who doesn't have any, or have a family member who doesn't have any ownership interest, but is involved in the business. You can have an owner of the business who's not a family member. But you can have these different groups, and each of these stakeholder groups needs to be considered as part of the succession plan. I mentioned management succession. Now, if the exiting owner has a desire for that business to continue on into the future, then you've got to start looking at what talent do you have on board? Who are the key leaders and management of this business? Who has that ability to continue it on once I'm gone? I think you also see, and I know I've experienced this with my clients, the business owner that's leaving the business, there is definitely a fear of letting go. And I can think of one situation in particular where every year it just got a little bit better. You know, the dad that was leaving the business, every year he let go a little bit. And I mean, now that business is successful with the second generation, but there were several years there where the fighting between dad and the kids was just nonstop. But like I said, over time it got a little bit better. There's other key issues that come up with succession planning. Alignment of family interests along those lines. I mean, a father-son relationship can be challenging to begin with. Case in point. I grew up in Pittsburgh. I'm a Steelers fan. That's where you boo, Bob. My son's a Steelers fan. Son, he's 9. He says, well, Uncle Jeff and Auntie Vaughn live in Cleveland. Uncle Jeff likes the Browns. We should probably like the Browns too, Dad. So you have those kind of dynamics and challenges with a father-son relationship. But think about a father who is leaving the business. Son's taking over now. Dad's getting a nice rent payment from the business because he owns the property. He's also got some compensation coming from the business. Not doing much with it, but not doing much in the business, but he's still getting a paycheck because that's kind of his retirement income. Son's taking over now. Son wants to buy some new equipment. Son's going to have to get financing for that new equipment. Dad doesn't believe in outside financing because Dad didn't have to get financing for anything. Dad also knows that his retirement income, that rental income, is coming from the business. He doesn't want the business to be detrimented by his son buying this new piece of equipment. Personally, Dad doesn't see the need for this piece of equipment. No, he didn't need that type of equipment in the business. He was successful, so son doesn't need it. So you gotta look at those different family interests. Balancing of financial returns. As a valuation practitioner, I can say that business owners almost always think their business is worth more than it is. Unless you're getting divorced. Then it's not worth anything. There's a reason for that. It's understandable that a business owner sees more value in the business than somebody from the outside looking at it might see. A business owner is pour their heart and soul into the business for 30, 40 years, they think there's a lot of value there. Well, an outsider looking at the business is going to hopefully do their due diligence. They're going to ask for tax returns. They're going to ask for financial statements. They're going to look at the numbers, and they're not going to see your heart and soul. You know, they're going to see the numbers. And they're not going to pay what you think that business is worth. Along those lines, Jeff was mentioning that there's other signature series topics coming up. The July 28th one, this is a little plug. July 28th is all on business valuations. Provided he's not angry about the Browns comment that I made, I'll be speaking at that engagement. But when you look at the value of a business, the value of any business are the present value of the future cash flows that it's going to provide to an owner. So, what do small business owners do? Well, I don't want to show any income because I don't want to pay any taxes. If I show income, I got to pay taxes. don't want to pay taxes. So, you know, get creative. You ask them questions like, you got any personal stuff running through there? They kind of smile and say, no. Well, if I'm looking to buy your business and I ask you for 3 to 5 years worth of tax returns, and I see a bottom line that doesn't look so good, and I ask you about it, and you say, oh, I ran a lot of personal stuff through there. Shame on you, first of all, because that's not right. Secondly, are they going to believe you? I mean, now you've got to convince them that, well, those numbers you see really aren't the true numbers of the business. It's hard. If you're looking to sell your business down the road, you got to pretty it up. My very first boss was a partner at KPMG P. Marwick, and he told me when he was a college student, he bought a car from a friend, like $400. Took it home. A few weeks later, he totally cleaned the car, detailed it, nice. Then sold it to somebody else for $800. Point was, he put in a little bit of hard work to make that car look good, and he was able to sell it for a profit. You gotta do the same thing kind of with your business. You got, if part of your succession plan leads to a sale to an outside party, maybe sometimes when if you're selling to the family, you wanna jack up the value, but that's less common. But if you're selling it to an outside party, you wanna make it look pretty. Not falsely, but you wanna do what you can do to improve the bottom line. You know, and along the way, you might have to pay some taxes. You know, you might have income that's higher than you want, but having to pay taxes and in the back end getting a higher value on that business, you know, it might be worth your while. Interfamily disputes.
Oh yeah.
Mom's gifting stock to a son who's not at all involved in the business. Also gifting the same amount to the daughter because we got to do things equally. So if she's getting shares and she's involved in the business, we got to give shares to the son too because they deserve equal treatment. Well, daughter's husband's also involved in the, or future husband's also involved in the business. Then her future ex-husband is involved in the business. You know, you can have those types of things happen down the road where, you know, things are going along, you're transferring ownership, and then all of a sudden something like a divorce happens. Your succession plan has to at least contemplate that. And what's going to happen in that situation? Estate and inheritance issues. Estate issues probably, I would say, aren't as big now as they were 5 years ago. And by estate issues, I'm talking about estate tax. The tax that a person pays on the assets that they own when they die. For a long time, that level was at one point, I mean, it was under $1 million.
It was $675,000 for a long time.
So if you had $675,000 in assets, you were paying federal estate tax. And the state of Ohio was like
$338,000.
Yeah, maybe you weren't paying federal estate taxes, but you were paying state of Ohio estate taxes. And again, that's a tax on the value of the assets that you have. Well, the Ohio did away with estate taxes 4 years ago. And the federal government has continued to increase the amount of assets that you can have. This year it's
5.45 million, and we have portability, which allows you to transfer your exemption to your spouse. So if you don't have that divorce, and we can plan properly without necessarily needing complex trust, we can protect almost $11 million in today's environment.
So it's, you know, I personally don't see a whole lot of estates at that level. I'm working on a valuation right now, though, for an estate in Athens. And it's going to be very close on whether or not there are estate taxes that are owed to this individual. That issue still exists, you know, and it's still something that can be a part of your succession plan. It also, you know, it depends on your business and how much your business is worth. Inheritance issues, you know, like I said, we see a lot of clients where the mindset is everything needs to be divvied up equally. Equal and fair are two completely different things. You know, does the son who's not involved in the business need to get an equal share of ownership in the business, you know, equal with the daughter who is involved in the business? Maybe there are other assets that can go to the son. You know, why money the waters by gifting him ownership interest in the business that he's not involved in? Maybe doesn't want to be, doesn't have any part of it. But, you know, we see that mindset. So that's one of the other issues that has to be discussed. And that's a big part of this whole process, is having those conversations and the getting over those hurdles. That's why it needs to be a systematic approach. And when's the right time to do succession planning? Now, you know, a succession plan is going to be revised, or should be revised over time, be modified. You're not carving it in stone, but the time to start it now, whether it's the short-term stuff, I mean, definitely the short-term stuff, you know, y'all need to think about what happens if I'm not here tomorrow. Not necessarily hit by a bus or a wood ornament, but what if you get disabled? You know, some things happen. So the short-term planning, there's no reason to delay that. The long-term planning, same thing. I mean, 2 years ago, Linda and I went to a course in outside of Dayton. It's a nonprofit company called Aileron. Anybody ever hear of them? It's a really cool organization. It's a nonprofit, and they do business coaching, leadership training. It was founded by Clay Mateel. He was the guy that owned IAM's pet food. It's like the good stuff. The dogs love it. We sold it to Procter & Gamble for just under $1 billion and took a lot of that money.